Thank you, Richard, for that good introduction. And I'm going to be talking today about the role of African scientists in feeding the continent. And this is a topic that is really near and dear to my heart, as it is to a lot of scientists in the agricultural sector, as well as biological sciences, with a focus to food and nutritional security. And really what is important about this and what makes this topic important to me is because a majority of farming or a majority of farmers in Africa are smallholder farmers. And these farmers farm in very small pieces of land, about 0.5 acres to about 2 acres in maximum. And these farms have high pest infestations on pests and diseases. They are characterized by very poor soils. And also because of the impending and because of the well-documented effects of climate change, any small constraint on these small pieces of land will lead to a lot of people losing their livelihoods, not only losing their livelihoods, but exposing them to extreme hunger and starvation. So we require very drastic measures or control strategies for this. And this will happen at many, many levels. But if you can borrow lessons from the Green Revolution and our experience with the Green Revolution to countries that have experienced the Green Revolution, then one lesson comes to mind, and that is science and technology and innovations, strategies tend to bring about positive change and change that can bring about revolution in agriculture. So even if the African problem cannot be compared, or the African agriculture system cannot be directly comparable to other countries, there are vital lessons and very valuable lessons that you can learn from the Green Revolution. And very simply, the Green Revolution, if can be summarized into three streams. The first one involved biological sciences, or innovations in biological sciences, while the other one involved innovations in mechanization or in mechanical technologies. And then there was the social aspect. And all this convened together to bring about a change that changed the way that agriculture was performed in those countries. So if we can dive a little further into the biological innovations or the biological, biochemical innovations of the Green Revolution, one of the key aspects was improved varieties, okay? So hybrids, and hybrids in this case meant improved seed, and what those brought about was higher yields. And also at this time, there was also use of herbicides and pesticides, and what those brought about was a greater or improved yields, because we were able to control pests and diseases as well as herbicides at a greater scale. And then mechanization, which brought itself aspects of irrigation. So water was no longer, rain-fed agriculture was no longer a factor, because now crops could be irrigated. That reduced labor, and in effect, the size of arable land became bigger. And of course, the social aspect cannot be overlooked, because of the financing of these smallholder farmers and the distribution systems, and these seeds are able to get to the farmers. And those farmers that could not be able to afford seeds, as well as other inputs or other inputs or agricultural inputs, were able to access this and were able to realize better yields. And so if we can be able to use agricultural revolution or science and technology in Africa, then it's possible that we can achieve some level of food security. But achieving this success in Africa is also met with challenges, and challenges that are very unique to Africa. So for example, whereas in most parts of the world, there is great innovations and there is great success in scientific as well as other innovations, science and technology has remained behind or has lagged behind compared to the rest of the world. And if I can give some data from UNESCO here, data from 2016 or close to that year, and if I can give my example, the example of Kenya, my home country here, to see the level of research and development investment, as well as how many personnel are employed full-time as researchers in, in these countries, you'll see that this is a very, very small number compared to the number in other countries. So you see here we have about 400 or thereabout full-time researchers per million of inhabitants. And this is one of the highest in Africa. Of course, the highest being the big brother in South Africa, which has about 800 to 900 researchers per million inhabitants. But these levels are still low compared to the world average of about 1,000. So really, there's not so much investment in terms of research and development in Africa. And there's a lack of well-trained personnel that can be able to execute the research and development agenda for food security. But this is not the case with the developed countries. So for example, if you look at the UK, there's a great deal of investment for R&D from the gross domestic expenditure. And also there's a very high number of researchers in this country. So for example, in the UK, you have about 4,000 or just over 4,000 researchers full-time to do research. And of course, the other countries that are developed, so you can see Germany there, Japan, as well as Korea, fair amount of investment in terms of research and development and a commensurate number of well-trained scientists that are able to carry out the research agenda. So in short, there is a threshold and there is a thrust from the research and development that can spur innovations. So what this investment in research and development overseas has done is to bring about explosions of new technologies. So you have explosions in genetics, you have genomics, you have bioinformatics. But what this have not done, in my opinion, is to bring about developmental change to solve real problems in the continent of Africa or in other developing countries. There is some translational research going on, but I think we could do better in terms of leveraging all these good innovations that are coming from the West to solve problems in Africa. And it seems to me really that there is a disconnect between these two groups. So on one hand, I have very good technologies and very good innovations that are coming from advanced labs in the US, in the UK, and other parts of Europe. And then on the other hand, I have some trained scientists, not enough threshold to execute a research agenda, but some trained scientists, but these trained scientists are not able to effectively communicate with their colleagues and peers abroad. And this is because of many factors, but some of it can be attributed to the barrier that is brought about by inability of these scientists to carry out research at a level that is comparable to these researchers in these other countries, or at least at a level that they are able to communicate and form strategic partnerships that will leverage on the advantages and the innovations that are coming from the West, with them knowing firsthand the problems of agricultural constraints in their home countries. And if you can be able to do that, then you can start to see strategic partners and form strategic partners that can effectively translate this research that these researchers in the developed country are so keen to see get into translational research. So at this point, I'm going to just pause and change gears and then just tell you the story of Striga smart sorghum. And this is really a Steven story, or a story about where we have come and the kind of leverages we have had on science and technology, and how we have been able to start to solve some of the problems we have in agriculture today in Africa, and very specifically in Eastern Africa and Kenya. So I'm going to introduce to you the plant that I work on. It is called Striga, and Striga is the beautiful flower that you're seeing in the background growing with a crop, and the crop is supposed to be maize. And what this parasite does is to attach in the roots of crops, sucks out nutrients, kills them, and leads to massive crop losses. We attribute crop losses due to Striga to be about 30 to 100%, and this translates to about $7 billion a year. And Striga is all over most parts of Africa, so you can see the infestation with the different species of Striga on that map, as well as the crops that Striga infects. So it would be maize, millet, sorghum, rice, as well as other staple cereals in Africa. And one of the reasons we think the parasite is hard to control is because the parasite is really, really successful. It has been able to learn to live with the host and synchronize its life with that of the host. So remember, it's a parasite, so it can only exist in the presence of a host. But the parasite has been able to know where a host is. It can be able to very accurately locate a host and know at what stage the host life cycle is. And this is really a lot of science that I don't want to go into, but to just show you the intricate or the way that the synergies in between the host and the parasite, or the way that the host has been exploited by the parasite, and the parasite exploiting communication signals between itself and the host and for its own advantage. So firstly, the parasite is really small. It has seeds, very, very minute seeds, dust-like seeds, and these seeds remain in soil for a very long time. Hundreds of thousands of seeds exist in soil or in seed banks, and this will stay dormant and inactive until there is a host that is next door to allow parasitism to take place. And parasitism only takes place if there's a host next door. And there's a host next door that happens when the host produces or makes itself known to the parasite by producing germination stimulants. These germination stimulants are hormones called strigolactones, and we'll not go into the biochemistry or the biological details about these strigolactones, but for now, let's just take them as molecules or signals that allow the parasite to locate a host. Once that happens, what happens is that the parasite now develops, starts to germinate, and after germination, it develops starts developing into the host tissue. And it goes very, very fast and very, very furiously inside the host tissue. And once it gets inside the host tissue, it establishes connections with the host. And it does this in cells. In plant biology, we call xylem vessels. And these are really siphons that the parasite uses to suck out nutrients from the host. At this point, the host is irreversibly retarded in terms of its growth. And this process is not reversible. And you can start to see the effects of the parasite 2 or 3 days after attachment to the host. All right, so this information exchange between the host and the parasite is very important to us, and it has taught us many lessons with regard to controlling the parasite. And one of the lessons we have learned is that some varieties of crops are not able to effectively stimulate the parasite to germinate. So they only stimulate a small number of seeds of the parasite to germinate. And once they do that, very few can be able to come out of soil and infect the host. What we have also learned from other groups is that this is because of a mutation that happens at one of the coding sequences of sorghum. In one of the sorghum DNA chromosomal regions is a region called low germination stimulant. And sorghum varieties that don't have a section of this genomic region do not stimulate the parasite to germinate. And so these are called Striga resistant sorghum varieties. And using very simple assays, it is possible to locate and to determine which varieties of sorghum are resistant to the parasite by virtue of them not producing the germination stimulant by just simple PCR or polymerase chain assays. And you can be able to detect if there's a deletion or there's a mutation on these genomic regions. And those ones that have a mutation on these genomic regions do not effectively stimulate the parasite to germinate and are called Striga resistant. And I want to pause here and list three important ways that we have been able to use this communication exchange or to leverage on this communication exchange between the host and the parasite and to develop interventions for Striga resistance and control. So one of the first things we did was to use the simple assay to determine if varieties of sorghum have resistance to the parasite. And we did this by taking a global collection of sorghum called the world, the global reference set. And most of these sorghum varieties are derived from Africa. So what you're looking at on my map with the colored dots, panel A, is a map of sorghum varieties that were obtained from different parts of Africa. And what you're seeing below it as panel B would be indication or a phylogenetic tree that indicates the phylogenetic relationship between the different sorghum varieties, basically the diversity of the sorghum varieties. And then what you're seeing on the panel C are the Striga endemic areas or the Striga distribution areas. And so what we realized was that most of the sorghum varieties that were sourced from Africa also overlapped with the Striga natural infestation range. And this provided a good source of Striga resistance. So once we did our assays, we determined that there were in fact some Striga resistant sorghum based on low germination stimulant production. And most of these were derived from areas where Striga natural range overlapped with the centers of domestication of different varieties of sorghum. So what came out of that work was a large number of sorghum varieties that were resistant to the parasite. So here I'm comparing the resistance of the varieties that we identified with the standard Striga resistant variety called SRN39. So SRN39 is a Striga variety that is known to produce low amounts that is ineffective in stimulating the germination of the parasite. And as you can see, we came up with a large number or about a dozen Striga resistant varieties that had a resistance level comparable to SRN39 or in fact higher than SRN39. Here's the more important thing. Some of these are advanced cultivars, others are breeding material, others are land races already being cultivated in different parts of Africa. What this means is that they can be integrated into agricultural systems in these countries. The other important thing that we did with the communication exchange between the host and the parasite was being able to go in and edit out the region of the genome in sorghum that was causing resistance, that was causing Striga sorghum to be susceptible. And a lot of people here would be very familiar with the two faces that are projected on my screen. In fact, these two scientists won the Nobel Prize in chemistry recently because of their discovery of genome editing using CRISPR-Cas9 technology. And so you can start to see how we are starting to leverage expertise and scientific knowledge from other colleagues in other institutions to solve a real problem of agriculture in Africa. And so what came out of that work was Striga resistant sorghum that was not able to in fact stimulate germination of Striga, at least at the lab level. And what you're looking from the panel in the red background are sorghum roots. And as you can see, there's Striga seeds that are just laying around there, not germinated, but then you have this other variety that has not improved, been improved using genome editing, and you can see the Striga or the seedlings have started to germinate, and this tells you that this are susceptible and this is a resistant variety according to Striga germination. But that's not the most important thing. A more important thing for us, or in our opinion, would be to go back to farmers and ask them which ones of the varieties that they grow do they prefer, and why do they prefer them, and are they high yielding, and most important to us, are they Striga susceptible? And if they are Striga susceptible, then we would go in with CRISPR-Cas9, edit out those regions in their genome and make them Striga resistant, and then feed this back to them in the agricultural systems, and hopefully we'll be able to produce Striga resistant sorghum. And next time that I take this photograph, I'll be standing in a field full of sorghum and no Striga infestations. And as I conclude, we can begin to see how such strategic partnerships can be able to be used and leveraged and harnessed to solve a real agricultural problem in Africa. So scientists in the West or in overseas and in private sector like whatever, who are very keen to see their technology make a developmental impact, in developing countries or in countries that have agricultural constraints of food production, can form partnerships and very strategic partnerships with Africans or African scientists who are aware of these constraints firsthand. And then these partnerships will be able to accrue benefits of improved food productivity in the near future. So with that, I conclude my talk and really acknowledge my university, acknowledge very kind support from donors, National Research Fund, as well as USAID, the National Academy of Sciences for a grant that I have with them, as well as the Royal Society for general support for a collaborative research project that I have with the University of Greenwich, Natural Agricultural Research Institute, International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology, who have also supported some of my upstream and basic research work, and really Corteva AgriSense for their kind support or their technology, and Penn State, where some of this work was initially done, my partners in Kenya, ICRISAT for seed material availability, as well as Publicit, and our communication partners, ISA. And then lastly, not forget to thank all my students who have worked very tirelessly to make our research a success. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Stephen, for a really fascinating lecture that has really shown us how this fundamental science is having very, very considerable impact on a key issue for the African continent. So thank you very much for that. I hope you're happy to have a short discussion now. I thought you and I would start the discussion and then we would throw it open to the whole audience. And one thing I liked about your lecture was that, as well as telling us about the science, you discussed some of the key policy issues. And you emphasized the absolutely key role of science and innovation in advancing economy and health in the African continent. But then you showed how, you know, low the investment is. I think that really came across in one of your early slides. What can we do about this? How can we boost the necessary investment in science and innovation in the African continent?
Yeah, so thank you, Richard, for picking that up. A lot of success in agricultural revolution in the past could be attributed to a critical number of scientists that were trained in those countries, and those were able to create a critical mass and a threshold of experts that were able to move the research agenda. And really, even if we, in terms of success of agriculture, instead of looking at merely the amount of yield that was realized or the amount of varieties that were realized in these countries, I think more importantly and a long-lasting legacy would be the level of investment in terms of research. But really in countries such as ours or in the developing countries, those numbers are still very, very, very low. And my theory or what my vision would be that investment in science in high-end technologies and then come up with solutions for a local problem. So come up with really good innovations. So like very quick winners, like very good winners, or what I like to call blockbuster products from a scientific innovation point of view. And then what will happen is that the community, the policies or the governments will start to see the benefits that accrue from training one of their own. So they'll say, oh, hey, that came from us, or that was one of ours that developed that. And then with time, they'll start seeing those benefits and they'll start putting in money in those research programs. So I think what we need are very quick wins and very good innovations. And then this would create incentives and policies on behalf of the government or on other governments that see the success that can come in investing in science and technology.
Well, I mean, your work is a very good example, but I mean, you're quite right, we need to persuade African governments to invest and realize that this is going to be a huge benefit for their nations. You talked about leverage and lack of connectivity. What do you think we can do about that? I know it's a difficult question to answer, but have you any thoughts?
Yeah, so if we can have investments in Africa or investments in developing countries, and then have these scientists being able to do science at a level that is that will allow them to communicate with their peers, then we can start to form those partnerships. Because here's the thing, Richard, so whereas we have a lot of, and when I say us, we, I mean scientists in Africa, whereas we have a lot of experience and knowledge about what constraints we have here, we don't have a lot of technologies, or we don't have ability to conduct experiments, or we don't have the level of investment and commitment from donors or from the policies here. And then on the other hand, there's a lot of development and there's a lot of new technologies coming from researchers overseas. And whereas these researchers overseas are able and very keen to move their technology and see that the investment in terms of research and their output, for example, instead of getting rewards as just publishing, then I think what we can do is to encourage an interface between these two groups, and so that these two groups can come together and form an interface of translational research, which really we are lacking. And if you can be able to leverage those advances and have these two groups meet together and create programs or projects with the aim of using the high-end technology to solve a real agricultural constraint, then I think that, in my opinion, would be a good direction to go.
Well, thank you. And just a follow-on question. What is the best way in which you think the developed world can help, and scientists in the developed world can help?
So, for example, and again, I've talked to a lot of my colleagues in the developed world. I've talked to a lot of colleagues in the private sector, and all these colleagues are very willing and are very happy to share their expertise. And the more that this can be made available to us, so for example, with not a lot of hindrances in terms of IP, in terms of corporations, in technology donations, in terms of visits, or in terms of exchanges that go into building capacity and developing capacity in the developing world, then you can begin to see fruitful projects that come to solve problems here based on experts abroad.
Thanks. And I was really fascinated in what you said towards the end of your lecture about the use of genome editing technologies. I got the impression that we're only kind of at the beginning of the road with the use of those technologies in your field. How do you think that's going to develop in the coming years?
Yeah, so I think genome editing is creating a revolution on its own. And I think for us here, I think it would be good to embrace this technology, in that it has capacity to not only increase precision in breeding, but also increase efficiency in breeding. So what I see is a situation where we should be able to be using this technology to improve our food security. And you asked where we are at this technology. I think we are just beginning to see this, but But I don't think we should be afraid to venture into this technology based within the continent. So I think this is a technology that we should embrace. It's a technology that is here for that has a lot of potential for benefits. And just because it's new, and just because it is practiced elsewhere, it shouldn't mean that we should not be able to embrace it here and use this technology to improve our productivity.
Yeah, absolutely. Just a final thought from me before we open up the discussion. What advice would you give to PhD students and perhaps other early career scientists in Africa who want to, you know, pursue a career, scientific career like yours?
In the words of my PhD advisor, Professor Nelima Singh, I would say just do it. Just follow your passion. Just do it. I think the most difficult thing is to make that decision, but would really encourage that. And in Africa, for example, and particularly in my country, because STEM subjects are looked at as being difficult, I think or I hope that innovations or advancement coming from Africa would have a trickle down, and kids will start to see that, hey, I don't have to be, you know, I don't have to study this and that. There's in fact opportunities for me, and there's opportunities to make a difference in life sciences, and maybe to just end, as you said, this is the question that you had for me last, to echo the words of somebody that I really like to emulate. Debbie Delmer, who was an associate, who was a director of food security at Rockefeller Foundation. And she said that there's a lot of rewards, or there's a lot of fulfillment that comes from knowing that you're using science to improve livelihoods. So I think there's some satisfaction and there's some reward that comes out of that. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to throw the discussion open. Please put your questions in the Slido, and I'm very pleased to see that quite a few have come through already. So I'll read out the first one, which is from Andrew Planet, who says, should we try and convert species that are annuals into perennials by breeding or genetic engineering, as this lessens the work needed to obtain a crop every year and might also give the plant more hardiness against all sorts of organisms? Any comments on that, Stephen? Annuals into perennials.
I think that's a possibility, and I think there's a lot of possibilities with biotechnology. I think for us it is to look any technology or such a technology within the confines and within the issue of the issues of food security that we have. And if that is something that is going to help improve food security, and I think it will, then I think it's something that we should pursue. But there's many possibilities. We just need to evaluate them within the confines of our needs. What food and nutritional needs do we have? And then also on our national priorities. But absolutely, that's one of the possibilities that technologies can provide.
Thanks, Stephen. Now there's a question from Charles Howie, who says, is there an effective network for sharing research findings, even participation between the scientists of SSA countries, creating a critical mass by virtual means? So research and data sharing between scientists in SSA countries. Any thoughts on that?
Very good question. There are some, I think, but I don't think there are enough of those. We have networks of scientists, and we have blocks of sub-Saharan scientists. We have what we call coalitions or societies, but certainly not to a level that we desire. I think there are some. So in genome editing, the initiatives, and there's a number of associations, or there's an association that links groups of scientists in sub-Saharan Africa. There are some for biotechnology. There are some networks, but I think we could do better. And that's a really important issue that I think we should take up and get more
proactive about. It seems to be a very good and interesting suggestion. And I'd like to go on to another question from Lara Donaldson, who says, do you think smallholder farmers are open to accepting modified sorghum strains or changing ways of farming if seeds and methods have been handed down from generation to generation? That is, are they accepting, are they willing to accept scientific intervention, or are they superstitious? Are they suspicious? Sorry.
Hi, Lara. Thank you for that question. And I think the way we approach this, I think this is mostly a communication question. But what we try to do is, as much as possible, get this from the farmers. So we want this to get initiated from the farmers. So, for example, what I finished in my last one of my last slides. So, what varieties of crop do you grow? Okay. And why do you like these crops? Would you like them improved? And if you like them improved, would you be happy to take variety A that is Striga resistant? And so we have taken an approach of openness in communication and getting to really understand what the farmers need. Because really, Richard, even if we developed a variety of sorghum that was super resistant to Striga and it was the wrong color, farmers would not take it. And so we have taken an approach, learning from mistakes and lessons, learning from mistakes of the past to get this come from the farmers at first, and then be very open about the communication. So tell them at first what we want to do. So like have an open meeting, like an inception meeting at the beginning of the project. Tell them that we are developing these products and these are going to have this trait and this and this. And then throughout the course of the project, we need to inform them and keep them in the loop. This is as far as we have gone. And also manage the expectations. Tell them this is not going to be a super crop, because also when we give them a variety that, you know, that get disappointing or not the results they expected at the end, then they'll not be happy with that. So travel the whole path and the whole journey with them, and then give them the product. A lot of communication, and with a lot of integrity and with a lot of openness. And I think this can help get some buy-in.
Yeah, it's really obviously really a key issue. I'd now like to move on to a question from Veronica van Heiningen. Can the discovery of the susceptibility gene in sorghum be used in other plant species to remove homologous genes and make those resistant?
That's a really good question on a very technical front. So the short answer is no, because the way that sorghum works is probably not the way that maize or another variety works. We haven't tried this, but I suspect there's going to be differences. So the low germination stimulant loci is not the same, or the way that stregolacton works or germination works in sorghum is not the same way that it works in maize, for example. And so the molecules that sorghum releases, the blend or the proportions that it produces would be different from another variety. And also the genes that the way that they are in sorghum would be different in maize. So for example, in sorghum, there are, as far as I know, two copies of the sulfur transferase gene. In maize, there is multiple copies. Who knows that maybe one of these may complement the other, the function of the other. So we haven't tried, but my guess would be, as far as the low germination stimulant loci, the one that was targeted in this case would be not directly transferable to maize.
Okay, thanks for that. And thanks for the question, Veronica. The next question is from Yannick Kleber. For Striga control, there was no mention of germination stimulants such as Strigol, the molecule shown in the slides. or the known GR24. Where do you see these in Striga control and management?
So I didn't catch the name of the person that passed.
Yonek Labor.
Okay, so Yonek, the germination stimulant in different in the sorghum variety that I mentioned is actually orobanchol, higher proportions of orobanchol compared to 5-deoxystrigol. So in most sorghum varieties would produce orobanchol preferential, 5-deoxystrigol compared to orobanchol. And orobanchol is a kind of a stregolactone that induces high amount of germination. So if you have the converse, if you have high orobanchol, then that means that you have low germination. So I guess that's the question. Did the molecules or the germination stimulant molecules that are produced in the root exudates of this crop. GR24 is a synthetic germination stimulant that is made in the lab and that we use as a standard. And the question was, would we use these purified compounds or synthetically developed germination stimulants in the control? The short answer would be in principle, yes, but then they're also very, very expensive to make. They have very complex synthesis stages, and they're also very unstable in soil. And so the feasibility of using these germination stimulants in the control themselves would be difficult. But having said that, I should also mention that there are very many groups right now working on analogs or lookalikes of these germination stimulants, and there are possibilities that this would be more stable, or this have been demonstrated to be more stable in soil, and in fact can be used as a strategy for controlling the parasite.
Thanks, Stephen. We've now got a question from Crispus, who asks, other than sorghum and other farm crops, are there wild plants that are hosts? Striga? If so, is there research to understand wild host Striga interactions?
Yeah, a really excellent question. And what we know so far about the interaction between Striga and its hosts, again, maybe I should have mentioned this in the presentation, but I didn't want it to be very technical. There's a dichotomy between the host of Striga. Okay, so there are some, so maize, millet, sorghum, or the grass hosts are very good hosts to Striga harmonica. And then there are also other hosts of Striga desmoides, which are the dicots. And as far as we know so far is that all grasses or maize, millet, sorghum, including their wild relatives, are hosts to Striga. To what extent then is a good question. Are we able to leverage, or are we able to obtain resistances from this wild or undomesticated host to achieve Striga resistance? And the answer is, for the most part, yes, most of these have been demonstrated to be Striga resistant. There's a caveat to that, and the caveat is not every wild is not always equal resistant. So the answer to your question, yes, there are some wild varieties and some undomesticated grasses that we can use to harness resistances from this, and these have been exploited. But take this with caution, not every wild variety is resistant to the parasite. But the question comes from the perspective, I guess, from wild and old progenitors or coexistence between host and parasite for a long time, and this may have developed some level of resistance and immunity that can be now reclaimed using tools that we have in genomics and molecular genetics.
Thank you again, Stephen. We've now got a question from Nadia Hashim, who says, well, first, thanks you for the enlightening presentation and discussion. And then says, other countries in Africa have applied nuclear technology in mutation breeding for, amongst others, the management of Striga. Do you have plans to use nuclear technology in your work?
Nadir Hashim, I believe that's the Nadir I know. That's a really good question, a really excellent idea. And I should tell you that one of the maize varieties that is resistant to Striga was developed through mutational breeding. Okay, but this is a technology that can be replicated in other crops. But I should also say it's what I like to call a shotgun approach. So you're hitting the whole genome and hoping that you'll hit a gene that is going to be responsible for resistance. The only drawback to this is that you'll have to go through a lot of screening, a lot of mutations. But once you get a mutation that confers a resistance, then this is inbuilt resistance, and this is stable resistance that can be progressed into other varieties. So yes, it has been done before, and nuclear and mutational breeding is one of the ways that we can use to achieve Striga resistance. And in fact, it has been used in maize and currently being tried in other hosts like rice and soba.
Okay, thanks very much. We now have a question from Esther Muema, who thanks you for a great presentation, and then says, is there a role of soil infertility in Striga disease spread to crops and plants?
Yeah, so lots of Striga biologists in the house. So the way that we understand Striga host interactions is that there's a factor of soil infertility. And remember when I said in my first presentation that it's in my first slides, in one of my first slides, our soils have very low levels of fertility. So the nutrient level is quite low. And Striga likes or thrives on nutrient deplete soil. And there's a very clear correlation between the levels of soil fertility and Striga infestation. And maybe this will force me to give a very small background, but I'll do it in 30 seconds. Striga germination stimulant signal is really a signal that's supposed to attract mycorrhiza to make the soil fertile or to make pea available to the plant. But then Striga hijacks on this signal and then germinates on behalf of the at the expense of the mycorrhiza. And so there's a very direct correlation between levels of soil fertility and Striga infestation. So the lower the soil fertility, the higher the infestation, with a direct correlation in the amount of germination stimulant that is produced. But also a healthy plant is a plant that has more resilience and more ability to cope with a pathogen. And so even though our soils are depleted, if there was an added level of fertilizer or inputs that help improve crop yield and performance, then this can reduce the amount of infestation.
Okay, thanks. We'll now take, I think it's a second question from Charles Howie. I think you may have addressed this already, but I'll read out the question. Charles says, you focused on Striga and sorghum. Can you comment on the spread of this technique to the other crop hosts of Striga? I say, I think you have commented on this, but you may want to say a little more.
Yeah, so I think that the question, maybe it's a little different. I think or maybe I did not address it adequately. So the question is, can genome editing be used? So the way I understood it is, can low germination stimulant directly on this loci be applied on other systems? And I said, maybe not, but can genome editing be applied in maize, for example, in rice for Striga resistance? And the answer is an emphatic yes. So the only limitation here would be which genes are you targeting? That should not be a problem now, because we have a lot of resources coming from genomics. There's a lot of discoveries and gene discoveries coming into light right now, and all we need is a good target, and there are very good targets, for example, in rice, and there's a lot of good targets in maize. So I'll not be surprised if genome editing work is going on for Striga resistance in other crops targeting other genes, and there are good viable candidates that can be used. So the technology has far-reaching implications on other crops as well.
Okay, a final question from me, rather a general one, and really what major breakthroughs do you see in your field, perhaps just over the horizon? Of course, we don't know often breakthroughs that are just over the horizon, but are there any you might see coming in the next 5 to 10 years?
I see as being able to, in a short term, being able to at least have Striga resistant sorghum developed using the technologies of genome editing, at least that in the near term. I see that spilling over to other crops of importance. I see in the next couple of years having discoveries that will allow us to more understand the basic interactions between host and parasite. We should be able to know what the parasite does to overcome host resistance. We should be able to know the factors or the interactions in terms of communication exchange between the host and the parasite. And this at a fundamental level, but very important in determining how we deploy Striga resistance so that the resistance is not only durable, but broad spectrum.
Good, well, thanks very much, Stephen. I'm sure the discussion could continue, but I think we need to draw things to a close now. And I'd just like to conclude by congratulating you again on this award. I think you've shown us in your talk the strength and achievement of your science that has fully justified this award. Just so that participants in the webinar know, Stephen, as well as receiving a personal prize, will receive £15,000 to support his research program. Well, we hope that that is a help for you. And Stephen, I think, again, as you know, the medal and scroll will be shared with you at a later date. But let me just conclude by thanking you again for a terrific talk and for all the very, very interesting discussion. Thank you for the participants for joining us and for putting your excellent questions to Stephen. Thanks, everybody, for listening. But finally, thank you to the Royal Society staff for making this event happen and occur so smoothly. So thanks again, everyone, and do have a very pleasant evening.